everyone here. On behalf of the Dodge family, thank you for coming this morning and being with them to send off Joseph Brooks Dodge Jr. We're first going to say thank you to Lauren and Eric, who played for us the prelude this morning. They will be playing again at Shenandoah at the reception after this service, and so we appreciate them coming and doing double duty this morning. And the rest of the music will actually be provided by the family. And so, it's a gift. All of this music is a special gift. A couple of just quick announcements before we get going. The first is that at the end of the service, anyone who wishes is invited to join us at the Shenandoah for the reception afterwards. If you haven't had a chance to speak with the family just yet, then please join us at the Shenandoah. The family will remain until everyone has had a chance to leave the church and go out to their cars and head out. And then they will be going over to the Shenandoah to join me. If you need tissues, there are tissues scattered throughout the sanctuary. There may not be a pack in every single pew, but there are many. So please, if you notice somebody sniffling, feel free to share a pack of tissues. They're usually in the hymnal holders in front. There are bathrooms back here. Anybody have any other questions for self-care before we start? Then I would ask you to join me in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would invite Susan to come forward to share with us the Wendell Berry reading that you can see on the back page, the inner back page of the book.
So for those of you who don't know me, this is my Uncle Brookie, my mother's brother, and my middle name is Dodge. And I have on a bracelet today that my uncle bought for my mother when he was in the Olympics, and she wore it all of her life that I knew her, so. Thank you, Dom, for asking me. O Saints, if I am even eligible for this prayer, though less than worthy of this dear desire, and if your prayers have influence in heaven, let my place there be lower than your own. I know how you longed, here where you lived as exiles, for the presence of the essential being and maker and knower of all things. But because of my unruliness or some erring virtue in me, never rightly schooled, some error clear and dear, my life has not taught me your desire for flight. Dismattered, pure, and free, I long instead for the heaven of creatures, of seasons of day and night. Heaven enough for me would be this world as I know it, but redeemed of our abuse of it and one another. It would be the heaven of knowing again. There is no marrying in heaven, and I submit even so, I would like to know my wife again. Both of us young again, and I remembering always how I loved her when she was old. I would like to know my children again, all my family, all my dear ones, to see, to hear, to hold more carefully than before, to study them lingeringly as one studies old verses, committing them to heart forever. I would like again to know my friends, my old companions, men and women, horses and dogs, in all the ages of our lives, here in this place that I've watched over all my life. in all its moods and seasons, never enough. I will be leaving how many beauties overlooked. A painful heaven this would be, for I would know by it how far I have fallen short. I have not paid enough attention, I have not been grateful enough, and yet this pain would be the measure of my love. In eternities once and now, pain would place me surely in the heaven of my earthly love. Thank you.
We believe that what is holy, the way that we understand the divine and the sacred in our lives, speaks to us even now. And sometimes it's not the words of scripture, but the lyrics from a song, or the words of a poet, or an image that has been taken by a photographer, that speak into our soul. And so these words from Wendell Berry spoke to Brooks' family about his love for his wife, and his family, and his world. We invite now Karen, is that right? To come forward. And then the family will be offering reflections.
Hi, everyone. For those that don't know me, my name is Karen. I've taken care of Brooks for 12 years. I've debated about speaking today because I think I could do this. But I'm going to try. I still remember the first time that I walked into his house. Scared to death. He was so serious and he didn't know how to take him. Sorry. As time went on, I knew it was such an honor to take care of such a wonderful, intelligent man. I learned so much from him, what has passed. I could have listened to him for hours. Sorry, I can't see my writing. I was thinking to myself one day, I said, wow, I'm taking care of such a legend. My job as a caregiver is so very trying sometimes. But I didn't feel like caring for Brooks was my job. I felt like I was going down to Jackson to be with my other family. I loved Brooks like a grandfather. What I would do to just cook one more meal, his favorite meal, favorite dessert, or just play another game of cribbage. Which, he was the one that taught me how to do that, and you always won, too. I never won anything. Never. But then I wouldn't know if he won or not, because I didn't know how to play. So being that, I miss him very much. And I also want to thank my family, Burpee, Roxanne, Crystal, and all the grandkids, for always treating us like family while we were there. Thank you.
So Michelle's going to come forward.
When I turned 5 years old, my grandfather announced that it was time to learn to play a game of cribbage. Always analytical, he loved games of strategy, and I knew this was a step forward, becoming a true Dodge. While he always showed great kindness towards me, he also knew that experience was the best teacher. And I quickly learned to count my points correctly, because we played for blood. In other words, if I miscounted, he would take my points, even though I was 5 years old. I still remember myself at 5 years old, counting the points of my second hand, 15-2, 15-4, and the rest don't score. After I touched the pegs, he chimed in, and I'll take the other two. Needless to say, I learned to count quickly, at least up to 15. And later, my husband learned to play, and the same technique was used, because anyone who joined the Dodge family had to learn cribbage the hard way. Even when he aged, he seldom forgot countless points, and while he needed help finding the pegs on the board, he never hesitated to take the points for a run. Cribbage was never a one-game affair, but was played in sets of three games at a time. When I think back to the moments I spent with my grandfather, some of my favorites were sitting around the board and shuffling the cards while we talked. From this game, I realized he taught me several life lessons, three of which I hope to share today. Lesson one, pay attention to the details. Sometimes a poor hand can be played well and result in a win. My grandfather was a person of calculated risk. He carefully studied each decision and planned for each scenario. And in an interview given later in his life, he recalled his days of skiing difficult terrain, saying, "I just thought of it as developing technique that would meet the challenge that I had given myself. I would always do it with minimum risk. If that's what they call extreme skiing, well, I never thought of it that way." But despite his careful planning, he survived an accident caused by poor luck, a water bottle rolling out of reach thousands of feet in the air with a flying glider. Luckily, my grandmother saved his life by being a squeaky wheel and demanding the best treatment and making those hard calls, while also being his biggest supporter and advocate. She knew that he would survive and go on to enjoy life afterwards because she believed it, and anything she set her mind to became a reality. But he was someone who always beat the odds. Even with his injuries, including a fused ankle, he went on to hike, bike, and ski again. Later in his life, he ended up hitting a moose at the bottom of the hill. It was a dark night, and he never saw it crossing in the swampy area in front of the old yellow town countryside. After getting out of the car and taking a look at the poor moose injured on the other side of the road, he proceeded to do the logical thing. He called my parents. Luckily, they alerted emergency services, and everyone was fine. Everyone on that call walked away without injury, except for the moose. Lesson two, take pride in a job well done. My grandfather loved recalling stories of his childhood and took pride in rising early while half the world was asleep. In other words, the best among us would wake up before 5:30 in the morning. But he was someone who valued doing your best no matter what the task. He remembered being sent to shovel the latrines at Pinkham as a kid and how his lack of ability to smell things well resulted in his ability to get done what others could not. He also took great joy in cooking. Always taught me a plan for three steps ahead to avoid an ankle turn or a sloppy footing. In our family, there was no sitting down during a hike. Instead, we were expected to take quick water stops and continue on no matter how hard or how tired we became. But this developed our strength, and I'm grateful for him for giving us a metaphor for working towards goals. Head straight to the top. And do not rest till you get there. At the top, we take time to enjoy the view and point out the mountains as we enjoy the rewards of lunch, and there is a sense of pride at reaching the top. And on the way down, we would play on the next mountain to climb, and he'd yodel joyfully, effectively embarrassing my sister and I as we sang German drinking songs. But later, I remember this with fondness, and I wish I could hear his clear baritone voice again. He was someone who set challenges for himself, but took the little steps to make sure each one could be attained with hard work, dedication, and an unshakable belief in our own abilities. Lesson three, recognize and celebrate a good hand. Each hand is a new experience, and there's a beauty that comes from a task accomplished with skill. And whether you find the cards in your own hand or those of another, you can always appreciate your own success or that of others. Taught me that with persistence, practice, and experience, we'll all reach that 24-point hand. And acknowledging the success of others cannot diminish your own. It's important to be humble and kind, even when you get stumped. My grandparents loved celebrating others, and often found reasons to gather as a family for special dinners, and were quick to recognize the accomplishments of others. They're incredibly proud of our family, and held on to the notes sent by my cousin Ivan, as well as the cards my sister and I sent them away from camp and later school. They loved having several generations of the family together and never failed to point this out whenever we went out to dinner, talked with friends, or traveled abroad. My grandfather held family dear, and he showed great love for his parents, my great aunt, and most of all my grandmother. grandparents were bound to each other. He took great pride in a job well done and expected the best from all around him. He showed incredible generosity and felt that seeing the world was the greatest education. A true adventurer, he delighted in seeing the world, and with my grandmother's planning, brought spirit and life to every trip, as well as a privilege board. Part of every trip would include my grandmother pulling out an enormous book of maps and history and reading to us and we appreciate the places we saw. And when my grandparents traveled, they'd spend months trying to learn a new language or diligently tracking every mile they hiked or biked as preparation. They never saw obstacles, but only challenges to overcome. And like each round of privilege, there's new lessons, experiences, and joys to be found. But despite their insatiable desire and delight in learning and seeing new places, my grandfather felt a strong connection with his home in Pinkham Notch and settled close by. He felt the power of the mountains and clung to them throughout his life. My grandfather never tired of playing privilege. He is a person who found joys in the simple moments of life and appreciated the little things, a cup of coffee, a good book, a close game of cribbage, and most of all time with family. The rules of the game represent his life, a series of strategic moves, good luck, and a healthy dose of grit. And while he is no longer physically here, I hope to pass on the same lessons to my children. Brenda, thank you. I love you so much.
And now Dominique can come up and share her reflection.
My granddad was a teller of stories, and standing here in his memory today, I wish I could tell you all of them. About the time Jigger Johnson hiked out of the notch with a crowbar at his shoulder, about Jigger and the Wildcats, or the way the old lumberjack used to crawl off to sleep in the ashes of the fireplace at Pinkham when my grandfather was a boy. I want to tell you how granddad was only 13. When his father sent him up to work at Madison Hut, because so many men were off fighting in the Second World War, and how he loved Madison with all of his heart, and how he was so small at first that he had to make two trips up and down the mountain every pack day to carry his share of supplies. I want to tell you how his mother, Shershin, taught him to make pie crust, and how he was so good at it that the other hutmen would always save any precious fruit for him to turn into pies, and how he taught me the same recipe when I was young. I want to tell you about the time my granddad and Bill Putnam served dinner at Lakes of the Clouds Hut, snuck out to Franconia Notch in the dead of night, put a beard of spruce grease on the old man of the mountain, and got back to Lakes in time to serve breakfast. I want to tell you about the mythical beasts of the White Mountains, the green-whiskered commodities, the side hill gougers, mountain-born mammals with legs longer on one side than the other, who can only circle the mountain in one direction. My grandfather came from a long line of storytellers, and he learned at the knee of his own father, Joe. He had hundreds of stories, and he told them over and over and over. In the way that storytellers do. And the ones he loved best were the stories of his childhood in Pinkham Notch. I would give anything to hear all of my granddad's stories one last time. But he did his job well, and if we had time, I could stand here and tell them to you. Not every last one, but enough of them. My grandfather was a teacher. He instilled in me an unshakable love of the natural world, and the White Mountains in particular. And he taught me the names of the Krumholtz and the reindeer lichen, the origins of the glacial erratics, the secrets of the alpine flowers, Cynopensia, Cynic oil, Labrador tea, the taste of alpine cranberry, the whistle of the cog railway, the smell of spruce trees, and the song of the white-throated sparrow. And you might not know, but he had a beautiful singing voice. And he sang the popular music of his day in a steady, clear, and unselfconscious baritone. And when he was stationed in Germany, he went to Yodel. And much to me and my sister's horror, he did this really well. Especially when his Austrian friends, the mountaineer Hans Moser, could answer him back from the neighboring hillside. And gruff as he was, my grandfather was a masterful teacher. And if he decided to take on a student in any discipline, his patience knew no bounds. He would offer lessons in gentle, measured words, no question too trivial, no effort unworthy. And it is no accident that my sister and I grew up to be skillful teachers in our own right. And this was a gift that he gave us. And it's one of many that never even occurred to me until he was gone. With his rough manner and no-nonsense nature, Granddad wouldn't have been an obvious choice for child care. However, he excelled at it. And sometimes he'd watch us after school, and he'd have carrots and dip waiting for us when we got to the house, with maybe a bit of his favorite salami and a cookie if we were good. And I think actually these were the things he also would have preferred to be eating. He was always young in his heart. He taught us to play Chinese checkers and cribbage and Monopoly and chess, and the three of us had endless games. He loved building models, especially trains, and his basement studio was a marvel of little worlds crossed and recrossed by their tracks, dotted with hand-painted lichen trees. He had a great skill for untangling our necklaces and fixing broken jewelry with his knife, wine glass, pliers, and just the right amount of glue. And I remember a time when I didn't think there was anything that he couldn't fix. When Michelle and I were 5 and 7 years old, Granddad took us up to Madison Hut for a visit. And soon enough, he was regaling a delighted crew with stories, while Michelle and I moved dishes through the sinks, standing on benches because we were so short. We were entranced with the whole thing, the cozy hut on the mountain, the clouds swirling around in the crumbles, the close bond shared by the crew, and maybe most of all, the hot chocolate. I think our future as hut masters was sealed in that moment. When Michelle first got hired to work for the AMC, Granddad was so proud, and he had every reason to be because she did her job so well that when I arrived for my first season 5 years later, I not only had to contend with the reputations of my great-grandfather and my grandfather, I had my own little sister to live up to. By this point, she was a hut master and frequently referenced as the gold standard for hard work, cleanliness, and delicious baking. Upon seeing a job half done, I heard more than one hut kid utter the words, "That's not how Michelle Dodd would do it." Clearly, I had my work cut out for me. I went on to spend 5 seasons with the AMC and was never so proud as when I got to tell my grandfather that I was the hut master at his beloved Madison. And as far as he was concerned, that was the only hut. He loved us so much. And he said, "Well, Dominique, my dad always told me the best way to lead is by example. Show your crew the quality of work you expect by working harder than anyone else." And one night, toward the end of that fall, the hut was half full of guests, and a big storm was rolling across the ridge. And in small, bedraggled groups, 25 crew hikers from the Appalachian Trail came to the door, hoping for work for stay. It's an AMC program where hikers exchange 2 hours of work for leftovers and the chance to sleep indoors. And we are only supposed to take 2 per night. But I looked out at the lightning forking over Mount Adams, and the rain and wind ripping across the ridge, and I thought of the nearest campsite over a mile away and likely full, with no other camping for miles. And any time I had a quandary as hutmaster, I ran through a litany of questions. First, what would Joe Dodge do? Second, what would Granddad do? And third, what would my sister do? The answer came back loud and clear. The latch string was always out. I took them in without a second thought, and that night was wonderful. We cooked up a bunch of extra food that would have been flown out as a second dinner. The thru-hikers told stories all night. The cribbage boards came out. And the next morning,
I set them all to work scrubbing the hut top to bottom. Around 8 a.m., my boss, Eric, the hut manager, called up on the radio with the news that the fall helicopter drop would be that morning and that he was on his way up at that moment with one of the big bosses from Joy Street. I looked at the 25 crew hikers cleaning my hut and I knew the jig was up. I said, Eric, that's right. Also, I took the 25 workers days last night. And he was like, you did last night. I said, the weather was terrible. And Madison Hut has never been so clean. It'll be okay. And also, I made cinnamons. He was like, okay. The granddad taught me that mountain hospitality is sacred. That the last drink is always out. He taught me that in order to lead, you need to earn the respect of your peers through hard work and integrity. He taught me that to be on time is to be early. I'm still working on that one. He taught me about generosity and love of family. He taught me to respect my limits and not to pack more weight than I can safely carry. He taught me to think ahead and prepare for life's circumstances. Through his stories and his example, he taught me what it means to be a Dodge, and to come from this particular family and this particular lineage, and to carry myself in the world with dignity and strength. And when it came to cribbage, he taught me to play for blood. He taught the game to me and Michelle when we were very young, on a boring grave of his father's name, a parting gift when his dad left the Navy. But our family has a special language of cribbage. It's a litany of phrases, responses, and jokes that have been codified over generations, and which is particular to us. My grandfather taught us this language, rich with rhyme and expression, and to this day I relish the chance to speak it. When he began teaching us the game, the rest of the family used to laugh and roll their eyes, because if we missed points, he would take them. Which, by the way, are the tools of courage. And this is called playing for blood. And in retrospect, he was teaching us an important lesson, which is that he thought we were smart enough and capable enough to count our own points. Giving us points we hadn't counted or earned might have appeared nice, but it actually would have sent the message that we were just little girls and not very good at math, or yet able to take responsibility for ourselves. And Granddad always believed in us, no matter how young we were. Anyway, we never minded, and we learned to count real quick. And to this day, Michelle and I don't miss points. And we're kind to others, but we're tough as nails too. So thanks, Granddad, for that. He loved my grandmother beyond all measure. He was so proud of her intelligence, her strength, and her perseverance. He'd tell anyone who would listen that it was her guidance and editorial skill that got him through Harvard Business School. He called her Canole, from the Italian word for pine nut, maybe because she was both small and precious. And he loved to sing praises of her fine cooking, of her Fulbright in France, of her ability to keep her finger on the pulse of life. And she followed him over every trail in the White Mountains, skied millions of vertical feet by his side, paddled countless rivers with him, and they cycled together all over the world. She was his anchor, and I know he felt lost without her this past year. And the week before he died, he kept asking, well, when are we going to see Anne? And I think in the end, in his simple, straightforward way, he just decided he'd go and see her himself. The last time I saw him was Christmas Day. Four generations of us opened presents by the tree. And at a loss for what to give an 88-year-old man who has everything he needs, I gave him a lifetime supply of British gates, his favorite way to pass the time. We picked up the worn-out cards, and we played around, which he won. And I left with every expectation that I would see him again. When my dad called 2 weeks later, he came as a shock. I found myself wishing for one last story, one last game, one last chance to tell him that I loved him. But the last time I saw him, I did all of those things. My grandfather died the best death I could ever hope for, having lived a full life, having spent that life with my grandfather, my grandmother, the love of his heart, and with his family. He died in his own bedroom, my father by his side, and he died quickly and well. The first time I went back to the house after his death, I walked up the well-worn path with my father, as we had countless times before. I went into the house and sat at our privileged table in my customary chair, and I knelt a hand at prayer, tears pouring down my face. And my dad came running into the house saying, "You've got to come see this. Come outside right away." So I ran out into the yard, and above us were a pair of red-tailed hawks. And they were circling the house and calling out to each other and to us, and they stayed over our heads for a full 5 minutes before they flew off together to the north. And my dad whispered, "It's them. It's Granny Granddad." And I said, "I know." And he told me later that my granddad often said that if ever he came back, he'd come back as a hawk. Because when he flew glider planes, he would spend time riding the same thermals, and he would be surrounded by hawks so close he could reach out and touch them. So I see this farewell as my grandparents' last gift to our family, the knowledge that they are together, that they are free, and that they loved us always.
It's a mark of trust that a family shares these kinds of stories with all of us. And it is a mark of respect and love and affection that all of you found your way here to listen to their stories and gather one last time with them. We know that there are many stories written about the Dodge family, about Joe Dodge and then Brooks Dodge. And he is part of the history of Dartmouth and the history of ski museums, as is his wife. Articles and stories abound about family. Each of us here, one way or another, has stories about the family. Maybe you knew them directly. Maybe you come out of affection with Brookie and Roxanne, or Dominique and Michelle. Maybe you come because you're a Jackson person. There are so many stories about this family. And you have heard some of the best of them this morning. I went over to the J-Town Deli this morning for a cup of tea, and they were telling stories about Brooks Dodge and his cribbage games. In point of fact, they were telling about a person from New Zealand who was a woman who could beat him every single time they played a game. And they were playing on somebody else's cribbage board, and he wanted, over time, he was getting really frustrated because he couldn't win, so he wanted to bring his own cribbage board, and they wouldn't let him. Maybe there was something about that cribbage board that was special. Every single story that I have heard about Brooks has included Anne in it. Yes, there are stories about his childhood, about his 13-year-old self working in Madison, and his triumphs on the ski team in Dartmouth and the Olympics. But so much of his life is measured in the company of the woman that he loved, Anne. He died less than a year ago. And as a wise person from the family said, even though Brooks was probably the one that looked like he was out front all the time, I'm sure a lot of the trail was mapped by Anne and marked by Anne, and she worked hard to keep up with him all of her life and to be at his side, right out there in front of everything. They loved to dance. They love to waltz. And his daughter Crystal remembers dancing on her father's feet because he loved to waltz so much. He shared that love with his daughter as well. It's one special memory she has of him. And among the other legacies of this family, certainly isn't it the love of being outside and using your bodies in special and healing ways. It comes down generation from generation, and it's understood and translated in a different way for each generation. And maybe Brooks was a surprising example of caregiving, but the girls learned that from their own father, too. Brooks and his wife, Anne, lived and died at home, and that was possible because of special caregivers and because of their own children, who loved them dearly and helped them be in the place where they were most comfortable and where they had dignity and security. And what an amazing gift that is for the people that you love who have raised you. The words that are told to me about Brooks and Anne are extraordinary, extreme, and competitive. Together, they were a force. And if Brooks was the physical side of their partnership, then Anne was the intellectual side of their partnership. She was the advocate that helped Brooks rebuild himself after that glider accident. And the way that they mapped the trails, and the way that Brooks recorded the altitudes and the speeds and where they were going next, their routes. He also mapped his family's lives. The girls called him the memory keeper. That he kept all of their words, and that he put them on boards and books and paid attention to the details of their lives, and that this legacy has also been passed down, and that Michelle is now that person who keeps the memories and the pictures for her family. We know that Brooks was not always an easy person, that Anne was the soft and gentle face of that family for others, and that much of his tenderness could be found in his love for his wife, and the way that he became such a gentle teacher and caregiver for his grandchildren. Perhaps the legacy of love is not in its perfection, but it's in perfection. But it took two people to create the family that is speaking here today and sharing their stories with us. And that in their imperfection, love came out in different and amazing ways and shaped the lives of new generations of Dodges and Middletons. And when we talk about Anne and Brooks together, we talked about the fact that, yes, Brooks taught often by experience, by placing people in very extreme situations and immersing themselves in it. For instance, leading them up the vertical face of Tuckerman's. And when you get into the top as teacher, simply saying, "Follow me and don't fall." But then leading the way, taking off, and getting far enough ahead to be able to turn around and critique what was happening behind him and watch the one that he was teaching. He often looked like he was the one that went first. And so for the family, and for their relationship, isn't it fitting that Anne went first this time? That she broke the trail? That she redlined the way to a place where everything that was broken, everything that was hurting, everything that wasn't perfect could be changed all over again? And that Brooks was looking for her. And that now, among the stories that the family tells, they found each other. And those two red-tailed hawks riding on the thermals are the promise of a love that goes beyond death, and a love that will meet us where we are, and a love that comes back in a new and broken body, connected to everything that is sacred, and leading the way for another generation into what is holy and all around us. We give thanks for the life of Brooks, and we give thanks for the love of Anne and Brooks. It wasn't perfect, but it was strong and extraordinary, and the greatest legacy that they leave comes in the lives of their children, Brooke and Crystal, their grandchildren, Michelle, Dominique, and Island, and their great-grandchildren, Tennyson and Langston, and their nephews, and the others that they taught and led. The stories have been handed down, but truly what has been handed down is the love. And so today, we begin the journey of letting go of the parts that weren't perfect, and holding on to the parts that were the best, so that we can cherish the stories that are ours to claim, and let go of the ones that we don't need to carry anymore. We give thanks and we honor the legacy and the love of Brooks and Anne. I would invite Michelle and Dominique to come up now and share with us music, which is another of the legacies of this family.
Michelle and I are going to first sing a song called Ribbon Candy, and it was written by a good friend of mine, Pete Sutherland. And I think anybody that grew up in the North Country and in the snow and who has a close family might find something to appreciate in the song. It certainly reminds us of our childhood and our grandfather.
Thank you. St. Gabriel Blessed. And so we'll sing the first verse, and then on the chapter first, you're all welcome to join right in and sing it with us.
So let me just say that again in case you're here that you've seen Edelweiss and you're invited to join in on the second verse. Adventures in the mountains and Brooks and Anne and Joe and Tina, friendships and your scary experiences too, all the different ways you may have known. We give thanks for the music of Dominique and Michelle. That was one of Brooks' favorite songs. Just came right out about the time that he was serving in the army or shortly thereafter, and they played on the traditions that were already part of his family. And so, friends, I'm going to offer you a benediction, and then we invite you to cherish the music that Dominique is playing, which is a waltz written for her grandmother and her grandfather. And then we invite you to find your way to your cars, join us for Shenandoah if you're able, and the family will follow you there. This is your blessing. In the words of Brooks, follow me, don't fall. And in the words of John Muir, nevermore, however weary, should one faint by the way who gains the blessings of one mountain day. You are in the mountains, my friends, and around you is the blessing that Brooks and Anne chose for their own, and in which they raised their children. Receive the blessing of this world. Receive the blessing of this community and your fellowship here and the stories that you will share. Go in peace. Go to receive that blessing and go out into the world to be a blessing in it. Go in peace.